Thanks a lot. So, hello, I'm George Charitakis. I work for Prodyna. And I would like to welcome you here. Here we're going to talk about the anemic domain model. And here is an overview of what we are going to see in the next 15 minutes. It's going to be a short talk. So, as a disclaimer, I say that that talk is going to be primarily for the newcomers that have recently joined the IT sector. And perhaps there's a chance that most experienced that are familiar with these concepts start thinking of those again. So, we live in the cloud era, and everyone talks about Kubernetes, containers, CI/CDs, and serverless functions. And those things are important, and they have vastly changed the way that deploy, maintain, program and manage our applications. And of course, they change the project management methodologies. Nevertheless, the core part of our daily routine as software engineers is the actual source code and of course the way that we organize it. And that is something that especially people that have recently joined the IT sector tend to neglect and forget. They are usually overenthusiastic with more abstract things. So I have decided to bring such a topic to the surface in order to motivate those people, start thinking about those concepts, and perhaps perform research. And as I said, today we are going to barely scratch it, so there's no detail here. And I'm sure that all of you, even if you are not familiar with those things, do implement it daily. So I have already talked who is about. And one good question is, why should you care? As ignorance is bliss. If you have more options and the knowledge of more options, you can decide more wisely about choosing tech stacks or doing different architectures. Especially what I'm talking about is about the actual software, the application layer. So some basic stuff about object-oriented programming. It is based on some principles. We have abstraction, inheritance, composition, encapsulation, and polymorphism. That's the way that we are taught during our university years. Inheritance is the following: when a class extends another, it is related as an is. For example, dog is an animal. Composition is when we have that attribute or the field inside the class, part of the class, and we can relate it as a have. For example, a person has a dog. We usually favor composition over inheritance. I'm just saying that. If you want, you can search about that. Another concept principle is encapsulation. We tend to protect the attributes that are in the side, inside the class from the outside world, and we can make them public for the usage as we want. Another concept is polymorphism. We have override and overload. Overriding it happens when a subclass implements the same method with the same signature as the parent class, and overloading when the same class has the same name method with different signature. And we have another concept that it's going to be useful, the mutability concept. Here we have a mutable class. When we are going to call those methods, the actual change is going to happen in the same instance. Here we have an immutable class. The second line here does nothing, but it returns another instance, and we can catch it like that. In general, classes should be mutable, at least in theory. Another framework, opinionated framework about Spring is Spring Boot. And here is a very typical Spring Boot flow architecture. Most of you are familiar with that. We have a database. We have a model that we get and fetch the data from the database. We have a service layer. There we implement some business logic, business rules or whatever, validations. We have a controller, and we expose things to the outside world. Here we have a typical structure of the Spring Boot. We have the controller there, the DTO, that finally that information is passed to the outside world. We have a mapper. We have the service and its service implementation, and of course the repository that gets all the data from the database. In theory, as we said before, with the object-oriented way, that entity could they implement a method. Let's have the method as a business rule in our mind, like that. For example, you have there the entity that represents something from the database, from the people that are not very familiar with that. And we now implement another thing. That calculates the year that person was born. But that's something that we rarely see, and most of us we have never seen in a Spring Boot project. Instead of that, the object-oriented way, we have seen something like that. We have a service, the interface, that we describe the actual behavior that we want to have, and we have an implementation. And if you see here, we have the actual implementation of the behavior. So that's contradictory to what we have learned in the object-oriented way. When we have a person in theory like that, we implement the behavior inside the class. Here, in order to have the behavior, the knowledge of the behavior, we depend both on the entity, the person, and the actual service implementation. So we tend to move the business logic or later the business rules in another class that's called service layer. So with that way, objects have a state, of course, but they have no behavior. They are primarily data bugs with setters and getters. We say podos or whatever. And that reminds us of procedural design. If you start implementing business rules like that in the service layer, it's kind of a procedural. That has, of course, some positive things and some negatives. One positive thing is that that model is really simple. It's relatively intuitive. And it's fast to implement. Most people do it like that. Easier to get in. When you come to a new project, the possibility is that it's going to be implemented like that. It's maintainable only if small. If there are not complex business rules, it's relatively maintainable. And the most important of all is very popular. It's really rare to see something else implemented. Of course, it's testable, but there are better solutions that make testing more easier. It's not so extendable. If you scale, if you are going to implement new things, it's going to the complexity is going to be increased fast, as I say here. And because all the business logic is implemented in the service layer, those services are going to be really bulky. And when the project, the application scales, those services are going to depend on each other and create a nasty nest. So some thoughts about that. Many people say that it's an anti-pattern, especially those people that love theoretical approaches. And they provide an alternative solution. The most known alternative solution is called domain-driven design. You can search for it because we don't have time to see like that. And especially in Spring Boot, we can search about hexagonal architecture. That's a really popular one. For me, domain-driven design, those approaches should be applied only if the microservices that we are going to implement are really complex with big business rules and significant business rules. And for simpler things like CRUD services or implementing a proxy or a middleware, we usually do it like that many times. We are okay if we use the anemic domain model, but it's a good thing to know what exactly we implement, because many things, many times, I have seen people that they are doing clearly anemic model, but they think that they're doing domain-driven design. One other thing that we must keep in mind is to being pragmatic and finding the balance and being a team player. When we get in a new project, we can share our thoughts, of course, but even if it is implemented in the wrong way, at least what I think, it's really my advice is to go with that. One thing also that we can have in mind is that technical success does not mean business success. Either way we go, if it works okay and is organized, scalable, maintainable, and all these things, it's okay. We must not be dogmatic about those things. And of course, respect other people's routine and choice. And be solution-oriented, because most of the time we tend to over-engineer, over-analyze, think about solution and make discussions, theoretical one. But we must have in mind that the actual solution is the target. That was the short talk I was talking about, and I would be happy to answer some questions, if you have, of course.
Thank you, George.
You're welcome.
Questions? We have one question over here.
Yes.
First of all, I'll say that I generally prefer anemic model versus mm-hmm. domain. But I think isn't another advantage of the anemic model that having the logic in the service layer,
okay.
doesn't it make it easier for transformations from the entity to the DTO and etc.?
If you search about, for example, hexagonal architecture or other domain-driven design architectures, you can see that mapping actually is the same. It can happen in another layer too. And so that doesn't affect the actual design.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Other questions? George, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for your time.